Hey, AfterBuzzers, we're about to talk about episode 4 of Sun Records with special guest Kevin Fonteyne, who plays Johnny Cash, so stay tuned.
You're tuning into the destination for TV superfan discussion, AfterBuzz TV. And now, let the buzz begin.
Are you going to sing it? Right before the show, Kevin was singing for it, and he was sounding amazing.
Tamra was ruining it. Tamra and the harmonies,
not so much. Well, thank you guys so much for joining us tonight. We can't even wait to get into it. We've got these amazing special guests, Kevin Fonteyne, with us.
Thank you.
And just so you guys can find us on social media, I'm Ally Nasta. You can find me on Twitter, at Ally Nasta, and on Instagram, at Ally Girl. And Kevin, where can they find you?
You can check me out on Instagram, at Kevin Fonteyne, and Twitter, at Kevin Fonteyne, as well.
Awesome. And Tamra Brown, what about you?
Find me on Twitter, at Brown Tamra, and on Instagram, at Tamra _ Blue.
Alrighty, well, just to kind of talk about this episode briefly, that ending was...
It's a shocker.
I was not expecting that. Tamra caught me watching it, but like I was watching it a little bit before they all got here, and I literally couldn't watch the screen because it was just like, I had to look away.
It was generally uncomfortable to watch somebody like... What do you call this? Jerk and...
You guys are girls, and wouldn't you like to watch Chad Michael Murray shake around on a bed?
I preferred when he was, like, naked earlier in the episode.
Yeah. Hello, Nadine.
I was literally like, yes, like, leave it to him with, like, button all. I mean, we did get to see that this episode, so I'm sure all the ladies out there were really excited. They got to see Chad Michael Murray's bum.
Yeah.
Is everyone 6 inches from the microphone right now?
6 inches.
Not
four. Not 9'6".
You know when they were saying 6 inches? I couldn't help but think about Elf when he's like, 6-inch ribbon curls, honey. 6-inch ribbon curls. Have you guys ever seen that?
Yes. So, as much
of a serious moment as that was, I was kind of giggling on the inside because of that.
It's adorable that's where your mind went.
I love Elf.
It's like literally the best movie.
Jon Favreau is a phenomenal director. Yeah. I hope to work with him one day.
Well, there you go.
Fingers crossed. Hey,
you guys heard it first.
Yeah.
So if this happens,
please send
some good jujus out into the world right now. But so Kevin, how exciting is this? You get to play Johnny Cash.
Really exciting, honestly. I mean, who else has done it? Joaquin Phoenix? Not a bad group to be in.
I mean, you're so
John
right.
Doe.
John Doe.
From X.
Yeah, right.
I mean, so like, what was that actual, like, when you found out you got this part, what was your initial reaction?
Shock. I honestly, my agent, my manager, and my lawyer called me, and they were all, my agent said, it's a burning ring of fire. And I was like, what? What? Oh, I got it? And they're like, well, usually if... Your manager, agent, and attorney are all on the phone with you. It's a good thing or a really bad thing, but this case, it's really good. So I was like, whew, it was awesome. I'm still like, don't believe it.
That's amazing. And like, is this a role that you sought after, or was it something that kind of came across and you were just like, oh, well, this sounds amazing?
It just fell in my lap.
Yeah.
I at the beginning of last year, 2016, I had made it my New Year's resolution to play my guitar every day for at least an hour.
Okay.
So I was doing
good
that.
One.
Yeah. Because it was just sitting in my room, and I was like, I'm such a waste of a person. So I was like, I'm going to play. So I started doing that, and then my first audition I got was Johnny Cash, and I was like,
that's
you know what?
Amazing.
I'm going to try.
So you had to play the guitar in the audition?
I did, yeah. My roommate hated me because I played Folsom Prison Blues over and over and over again. And he was like, how many times are you going to play a song? I was like, until I get it, man. And
like,
I got
until
it.
I get this part.
Yeah.
That is so...
And I still play it now. Yeah. And my roommate moved out, so obviously I drove him crazy.
Yeah. You're like, moved out. Now I can play as much Johnny Cash as I want. Yeah. But, you know, this episode, Johnny got into some fights and some craziness.
Yeah.
So do you do your own stunts, or is this something that, like, did you guys actually have to go and fight? What kind of training was this like?
We practiced, stage combat for like 2 days before with our stunt coordinator, and we had it all.
What was the name of
that.
The choreographer, the fight choreographer? We can look it up.
He's gonna kill me. He's gonna kill me.
It's okay.
I know his name. Oh, it's in there. I swear it's in there. I'll remember it.
It's okay. Just
I can see his face.
Yeah.
Yeah, I know. But we worked it out, and
I'll be over here.
during rehearsal for it, my arm went through the bag one time because I had to do a tackle, and my arm went right through the crack of the bag, the mat,
and I
smashed right in the cement, and I got this huge bruise. I posted it on Instagram, so you can check it out if you want.
I think I actually might have seen that.
Yeah, I had my arm up like this. It was all bruised like crazy, but I ended up not having to tackle him in the in the shoots, but I did throw a lot of punches, and then we did it like 40 times or so. Because there was just so much coverage they wanted to get.
Yeah, because they've got to get it from, like, every angle.
Yeah.
So, well, you also, like, speaking of, like, filming and shooting, when you guys are doing your scenes, do you get to work a lot with the other actors on set? Because you kind of usually do some standalone pieces.
I mean, for the main cast, I kind of don't really do any scenes with Chad or Drake. I had one scene with Drake, which is in a later episode, but they kind of cut our one line with each other because of time, or I'm not sure exactly why.
Yeah.
With all my other actors, we would Roland was all about getting the lines perfectly memorized, or so that way, like, saying them so many times rapid fire in your head that it just becomes mush.
Yeah.
So you don't think about them anymore,
right,
which is a great idea.
Yeah.
Fortunately for me, though, I have a photographic memory with my lines.
You do? Oh, wow.
I don't.
That's crazy.
Yeah.
So, like, can you read any piece of paper and, like, memorize it?
It pertains mostly to scripts. I don't know why. I just retain the scene so much and where I'm at. But I do remember a lot of, like, song lyrics. I don't know. I just have a weird memory.
That's so cool.
Yeah. You're meant to be an actor,
I guess
huh?
I am.
Yeah.
That's so crazy.
So he was saying during the fight scene, I was asking where they filmed that.
Yeah.
And he said it was downtown.
Yeah.
And there's like I think I know what bridge you were talking about.
Yeah.
Because they do a lot at that bridge.
It's over by, I think it was the Blue Monkey Bar.
Downtown Los Angeles.
Downtown Los Angeles, yes. Los Angeles, Memphis.
Germany.
I think it was the Blue Monkey was the name of the bar. It was pretty close to it. And it was just under this little bridge that they made it look like this derelict, abandoned.
Yeah, because it's supposed to look like Germany, right?
Yeah, or like wartime Germany, you know? So,
I mean, hey, it did the trick, I guess, because I was convinced.
Yeah.
That's crazy that you have... I'm, like, still on the photographic memory thing.
Yeah, I can solve a Rubik's Cube in, like, 3 minutes.
No way.
We should have brought one on the show for you. I wish I would have known.
Next time
for sure. Geez, well, you know, I kind of, like, I wanted to do a little quiz for you.
Okay.
And how well you know Johnny Cash. But before we get into that, the pressure is on. What was your studying like? Like, what kind of studying did you do in order to be prepared for playing the role of Johnny?
Dressed in black.
Unfortunately, I'm not wearing black at all in this season because I'm not the man in black yet.
He's not the man in black yet.
Haven't donned the black.
That's all right.
You're still in the innocent stages.
Yeah. Although I got a little tainted in this episode.
You did. You had a little peer pressure, would say.
I succumbed to the peer pressure. But my process was full-on immersion. I just listened to nothing but Johnny Cash for, like, the 2.5-3 weeks that I was auditioning, just all of his older stuff, you know, because that's where I was portraying him, not like, you know, hurt, but, you know, cry, give my love to Rose, Folsom Prison Blues, obviously, all of his early stuff, Doggone Lonesome. So I was just listening to that over and over again, and read as much as I could. I read his autobiography and his biography, and watched as many interviews as I could to try and get a little bit of his mannerisms and his voice down. So,
let me ask you this: in that scene when he goes in the brothel, I was thinking, like, he wouldn't have been that innocent. Do you think he would have been as the show made him so, like, just the country bumpkin? Do you think he would have been like that?
I'd like to believe he would be, because I wanna believe everyone's good. But, you know, you're a couple years out without seeing your fiance, or not even fiance yet.
Yeah, and I was thinking this ain't his first rodeo. Come on, JR.
Yeah, you know, I mean, he definitely had his fun later, so why not get started? I don't know. I want to hope that he wouldn't have, but
yeah,
guys are guys, I guess, right?
People are people.
People are
people.
Yes.
Yeah. Thank yes. you. Love that. Well, you know, well, so did you do any, like, actual research of, like, you know, figuring out, like, things of his past to kind of know what you felt was real in the storyline versus what was maybe scripted?
Oh, yeah. I mean, the brothel thing, I don't know if I ever read anything. No, yeah. I don't know if I ever read anything about a brothel. And then
I think that's a little too much into the story.
Yeah, and I mean, he was also more about radio communication in the Army.
Okay.
I mean, in the Air Force, because he wanted to, he thought, radio, I love music. How, mm-hmm. That's how I'm going to get into music. So he just wanted to learn everything about radios. And so he actually was like, doing Morse code and
that's crazy.
Don't really, they don't really tap into that.
Yeah.
You're killing it.
I'm quick.
I'm quick.
I know.
Well, with that being said, can we cue some music up? We're gonna do some quick questions of how well you know Johnny Cash.
Rapid right. Ring of Fire.
All right.
Here we go.
I don't want to fail.
So
I already have the job. Come on.
Yeah, I know. I'm sorry. I had to put you on the spot.
Okay.
So when he was invited to, when was he invited, what year, to perform at the Grand Old Opry for the first time?
Ooh.
1956? You're so right. Yay. That was right. Amazing. Okay, next. How many siblings did he have?
He had two.
Six.
That's right.
I read six. But no, I thought he had two, too. I, like, didn't know that until I was finding these questions. So
that's right.
Fair enough. I feel like they don't talk about...
They talk about his older brother and younger brother. I met his younger brother, Tommy.
No
way. You did?
Yeah.
Oh, cool.
How was that?
Great.
Yeah?
Yeah. I think he signed off on me as Johnny.
It was all right.
Yeah, it was cool, I guess. He has a little cameo in the show, so you'll see him later
on.
Wait,
yeah. I'm going to ask you about that right after we finish these questions.
Okay. All
right. So when was he born?
He was born... February 26, 1932.
Amazed. No, you got. No, it was sorry. 1923. But
19,
that you said 1932, right?
It's 1932. Was when he was born. Maybe. I promise you. I promise you. You. I think you might have had dyslexia when you wrote it down.
I did. You know. Yeah. I think maybe it was late at night. That was. You're so right.
Yeah. Because he was 24 when he got invited to the Grand Ole Opry.
I'm sorry, guys.
It's all right.
My fault. Okay. So, which song shot to number one on the Billboards? Cry, 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 or I Walk the Line?
That was Cry, Cry, Cry.
It was I Walked the Line.
I Walked the Line.
Yeah, got it.
You although
got
we
it.
Don't know at this
yeah,
point.
Yeah. This one I can see wrong. Okay, and how many kids did he have? And name one.
Well, John Carter Cash.
Okay.
Yeah. Roseanne Cash.
Roseanne Cash. Was it five kids?
Yeah.
Yeah.
Okay, so basically you won all of those right. I'm going to give you, like, round of applause.
I made a couple mistakes, but it's fine.
It's okay. I made a huge one with writing my numbers backwards.
It's cool. I do the same thing.
Yeah.
I have slight dyslexia. I mean dyslexia.
Well, with that being said, you said you met his brother.
I did.
What did you said he kind of checked off on you being Johnny?
Yeah. Yeah. He was like, you know what? You kind of look like Johnny when he was younger. And I was like, whoa, all right, great. And I sat and talked to him for a good, like, 35, 40 minutes.
What a cool thing. Where's his brother live?
His brother, I believe, lives in Nashville.
Somewhere in Tennessee. Oh,
yeah,
cool.
Yeah.
Okay.
Yeah, so it wasn't too hard of a trek for him to get over to Memphis to shoot with us.
Yeah.
Yeah, that's amazing. Yeah.
I was trying to go see him. He was supposed to perform, actually, and they were trying to get me to, but I think I was scheduled to film on the day that he was playing and performing.
Oh,
which
nice.
I would have loved to see.
Yeah. I bet. Geez, that's because even last week we were talking to Christian and he met Jerry Lee Lewis himself and got like kind of the okay from him, which is insane.
Yeah, he said that, Christian, hey, what's up, man? You said give you a shout out, so I'm giving you a shout out.
We're doing it now.
And Jonah, I love you too. Bye. He said that Jerry Lee kept like winking at him when he met him. Yeah, it was like, what's up, man? And like,
that's so cool.
Wow, yeah.
Oh my gosh, I'm gonna bring up the live chat too so we can kind of chat with some people in here and see if they have any questions for you.
It's such an amazing honor for it to be signed off by, well, in your case, it can't be the man himself, but like a member of the family, just because with all of these guys, they've all been portrayed multiple times. So for you to come in and they're just like, yeah, you're doing a great job.
Yeah.
I mean, that's really awesome. It must be awesome to hear as an actor.
Yeah, it was really, really great. You know, And it was kind of like meant to be, as I said, I was playing guitar. That was my New Year's resolution. Then my first audition was to play him. And then I booked the role on his birthday.
What?
February 26th is when I found out I booked the job. So
cool.
It was kind of like,
It's like,
thanks, brother.
Yeah. That's appreciate like, I feel like that's a sign off on, like, on yeah. him. He's just like, hey, I agree. You should be this yeah. person. We've got some people in the chat right now.
Okay.
And someone asked, Alyssa Rogers said, hey, Kevin, who do you think is the funniest cast member?
Oh, Alyssa, that would be Kira O'Donnell. He is hilarious. He is the king of our group that we created really? Over there, the bad boy crowd. And he's
bad boy crowd.
Yeah.
That sounds like fun.
Yeah,
I want to hang out with you guys. We were talking about, we're like, we need to come on set or something.
Yeah,
this would be fun.
We'll play some darts and go to some bars. Have
some wild turkey.
Have some wild turkey. Neat.
Yes.
You're welcome, Margaret Ann.
Yes. Mary, we're talking to her next week.
She's a doll.
She's amazing.
She's a doll.
Marion's character this episode, she just kind of came into her own. I was just like really shocked, and she just stood up for herself.
Yeah.
And she was just she's striking
Which
as a person.
Which is great because
yeah.
she was so pivotal with what Sun Records did.
Well,
Definitely.
I mean, we were talking about how she was the first person to actually record Elvis Presley.
Yeah. Sam didn't like him.
Really?
Sam thought he was bad.
Oh, my gosh.
Yeah, he was like, yeah, he's boring. Because the first thing he played was my Happiness, the little... kind of ballady song, and he was like, no, that's not, I can't sell that.
He was like, what's with that lip curl?
Yeah, yeah.
Put your lips together. Yeah, right. I don't get it.
Oh my gosh. Yeah, no, I think she was just like, it's just crazy, because I didn't know any of this history prior to watching this show. Tamra knows a little bit more than I do about Sun Records, because she's a huge fan of Sun Records as it is, but yes, yes, all the way.
As you can tell.
But it's just so cool to see that she had such a big impact on like how this became such a success.
Yeah.
And obviously this is scripted, but it's telling and portraying the story as real time or like as it happened. So I just find it so endearing, and all these stories and how they're colliding is...
Well, you know, you got the racial topic and the women's right topic there too. It was such a tumultuous time in the country of change and revolution that this was a catalyst to that.
Definitely. You know? Definitely. And even for her to, obviously she's in a sticky situation with Becky, and she's there for her at the same time. Like, she knows what she's doing and she feels is wrong, but at the same time she's there for her. She's not like shoving her away when she feels like it's awkward, which I think is very strong. We've got some people in the chat saying, Kevin, let's eat a pizza.
Okay.
Allie Scott says.
Oh, Allie. How's it going? You want to bring me that pizza now? You can.
There's several people saying, let's eat a pizza.
Well, she tweeted at me earlier that she was...
Oh, did she?
Yeah, because someone asked how to get to my heart or how we could go on a date. And I'm a Patriots fan, so one girl was like, we'll go to a Pats game. And I was like, that's a good start. And then Allie replied, I'll bring you some pizza. And I am a pizza fanatic. So.
Me too. I saw actually on your Instagram, you said you're a professional. A pizza professional.
Yeah.
Yeah. Wait, so what's your favorite type of pizza?
In my stomach. No.
I think everybody can agree
actually,
that pizza.
There's this great pizza in town called Quickies.
Domino's?
Yeah, Domino's is always good. Papa John's too, that garlic sauce. I don't know what they do, but Quickies. It's this cool little mom and pop shop.
Mm-hmm.
Here?
Yeah, it's at like Moorpark and Laurel Canyon.
Yeah, me neither.
Yeah, it's some of the best pizza I've ever had in my life.
Shout out to Quickies.
Quickies. Yeah. Hook it up for
Give
life.
Give them some.
For life.
Yeah, seriously.
I will eat it every day and then I will die.
Yeah.
Happy.
Oh, I love that because I love pizza too. Pizza is just like probably one of the greatest things in the world, in the life, whatever. Anyways, so connections with Johnny. Maybe he didn't like pizza, but do you feel like you have any connections with Johnny Cash? Like personal traits or anything that you guys kind of collide into one?
Did you ever build a car one piece at a time?
No, I built a rowboat, though.
You did?
Yeah, I built a wooden rowboat in eighth grade and donated it to charity. It was an 18-foot rowboat.
That's so nice.
Yeah.
There you go.
Yeah, that
that's
cool.
Similar.
Yeah.
Yeah. I mean, hey, that's getting people places. So.
It is. It is. A lot of my family was in the Air Force. My parents met in the Air Force, so I couldn't join the Air Force because I have asthma and I have nut allergies. So
oh,
I don't
no.
know if Johnny... had any of those, but Air Force is a big part of my life.
Yeah.
Yeah.
That's
aim high.
Yeah,
aim
I think so. I think that's a great connection.
Yeah.
Well, just talking more about this episode, we saw Jerry and Jimmy we're seeing more of them. We're getting little pieces of everybody, and it kind of is like the stories are getting longer and longer. Mm-hmm. You seem like you want to say something.
No, I just love them.
They're amazing. I love
their chemistry on screen is so great.
It's so endearing to watch. Yeah. And just like we got to have the pleasure to speak with them last week, and they're so nice. They're so talented too.
And they're British.
Yeah.
I know.
What? Oh, that's what that explains a lot.
Yeah. Wait, Tamra, you're being sarcastic, right?
No, we played like each other's accents last week. It was fun.
Yeah, yeah.
Because awesome. I'm obsessed with accents.
Yeah, yeah. Tamra put me on the spot, and it was really embarrassing. I was like, I'm not good at this.
I don't know if I am.
Throw out your English accent.
My English accent would be a little bit more like this, I think. I know Christian and Jonah are probably really mad at me for talking like this, but. Good day, mate.
There you go. Now,
throw another shrimp on the barbie, right?
Now we're going to Australia. We're talking Australian accents.
Bombay is very beautiful. Get it.
That's amazing.
Know, they're laughing at them yeah. right now.
I bet they are. People in the chat are laughing. People are saying, what is life?
We should have asked them to do a Johnny Cash impression, though.
Yes.
Oh, well.
Next week, we'll ask Marion to do that. Yeah.
I would love to hear that. Let's do it. I'll tune in for sure.
We really will. Well, Jerry and Jimmy, they're fighting over Peggy.
Yeah.
Which is, it's really funny because just that whole scene with all of them saying like, amen. And Jerry just swooped right in there and snatched her up with her dad. Mm-hmm. Winning the dads over. That's been a theme of this episode.
Yeah.
Yeah. With Elvis winning Trixie's dad over.
Yeah.
So that storyline is really intriguing to watch, but it's because it's like you never really, I didn't see Elvis when he was younger. So you're kind of seeing this fun side and like a younger innocent side of him. Mm-hmm.
He walked right up to her dad with an axe in his hand, too.
Yeah, that is something. I was like, what a gentleman.
Yeah.
He's really just, Tamra, what are your thoughts? You're thinking something.
Oh, no.
Oh. But I was thinking, what a gentleman. Yeah, like he came right up there and he's like, I got to make this right. And he did. And it was amazing.
Yeah.
So what are your thoughts overall, like on this show and like watching it back after working on it? Like, how does it feel to kind of watch your art be played out?
I always get so insecure watching myself.
Really?
Yeah, just, I don't know. I'm weird.
I don't think it's weird.
I'm always like, that's what it looked like. That's what I did. What am I?
I think that's pretty normal. Yeah. Like, people can't stand the sound of their own voice.
Yeah. So. And I'm super critical of, like, so watching it, then the show is phenomenal. Mm-hmm. Roland Jaffe, our cinematographer, everyone that worked on the show, our whole crew, like what they created, it really is art. I mean, it doesn't look like a television show. It looks like something on HBO or a movie, you know?
Yeah.
So I'm ecstatic and I'm over the moon at the finished product, but I always get like, I don't want to watch myself when I come up, you know?
That's okay.
Yeah.
Yeah. Understandable.
I mean, honestly, as fans of the show, you're doing a great job.
Thank you.
So you have nothing to be insecure about.
Thank you. I appreciate that.
I think all these people. Oh, Christian's in the chat. He says, what's up?
Get it. What's up, Christian, mate? Good to see ya.
People are saying, hey, Christian. You guys are doing a phenomenal job. And something that we've kind of continuously talked about is how convincing everybody is. And the act, like, down to the articulation of everything, I can't get over it, and I continuously repeat how amazing it is, and it's really exciting to watch the stories develop.
Fern and Sharon did a great job at finding everyone.
So those are the casting directors?
Yeah, Fern and Sharon.
Gotcha.
Yeah.
Fern and Sharon, shout out. You guys have picked some phenomenal actors. I want to talk about Sam Phillips for a second and, like, Chad Michael Murray and his character. Did you kind of know anything about any of these, like, Sam Phillips and what he did for Sun Records beforehand?
No.
So did you do a little research, or are you kind of seeing it play out in the show?
Yeah, I read Leslie Greif, our executive producer and the creator of the show. He gave us a reading list of things to do after I got the job, and one of them was to read the Sam Phillips book and the man who birthed rock and roll. So I read that, then that's when I started to get introduced more to his story and the things that he went through, and then I went towards Sun Records a bunch, and I don't know if you've been there.
I've always wanted to go.
Yeah, it's amazing. When you stand in that room, you feel it. You know?
Every friend that goes to it always brings. I have magnets and buttons and a little mint, a thing that held mints. And I have so much swag from Sun Records because everybody knows how much I love it, but I've never actually been.
Oh, you should definitely go. It's amazing.
Tamra, I think that's a trip you need to plan for the summer because
that... Don't go in the summer.
Oh, is it too hot?
It's really humid, so don't do that.
Okay, so not the summer. Maybe
like... There's like a September, I think, is when they do the Goner Festival there. Mm. And I've always wanted to go to that.
May's cool, too, because then they have Memphis in May. Mm-hmm. It rains then, so it's not really humid, and it's not too, too hot. And they got, like, a music festival that they do and all the barbecue, and it's pretty great. So it's a cool little time to be there.
Yeah. I mean, you guys, like, I feel like even capturing, like, it being in Memphis, even if some things are filmed in L.A., it's totally capturing that, like, old-time vibe, which actually leads me to a question. I'm wondering, so what, like, do you guys actually film, like, those walking the streets in Memphis? Like, is it all there?
Yeah.
Walking
really?
In Memphis.
Yeah. I'm walking in Memphis. Yeah, we that was the first time I listened to you when I got the plane.
just like in L.A., you got, like, hopped off the plane in LAX. Like, everywhere.
Okay. We filmed literally everything there. Or in the surrounding little towns in, like, Arkansas or... Mm-hmm. Just outside of actual Memphis. It was all and when you see exteriors, that's all over there.
That's so great. Yeah. It's cool to know that it's not just like a set and something that's not only capturing these stories, but capturing like the real aesthetic of everything.
The Sun Records studio, though, for the show is a set.
Oh, okay. Well, and I guess you would have to kind of...
Yeah, because I still record there and...
That would be too much for like... walking.
Yeah, but they did a phenomenal job. If you when you go,
yes,
you will see that the replication they made is incredible.
Oh, okay.
It looks almost exactly like it.
Oh, wait, so that's good to know.
Yeah.
Wait, so is it like what do you mean when you go? Like, what's the replication of the set?
The interior of the studio where Sam was saying the 6 inches.
Yeah.
That is a set.
Oh,
They built that.
To
replicate the studio of Sun Records.
Oh, but it looks exactly like it.
It looks exactly like it.
That's really cool that they did
It's incredible.
Yeah. I used to work at Cheers when I was in college, and all the tourists would come in and be so disappointed that it didn't look like Cheers. And I was just like, I thought everybody knew that the real Cheers doesn't look like Cheers.
Yeah.
But Sun Records looks like the real Sun Records.
You're in Boston?
Huh? Oh,
yeah. Yeah, great. I'm from New Hampshire.
Oh, that's right. Yeah, I saw that. Yeah.
East Coast.
Yeah, Patriots.
I mean, <Ed Sox. laughs> let's not talk sports now. I can't really. Sorry, God.
I just thought of something. Oh, the cool thing about being in Memphis, I would think, is that, you know, there's not many of these Sun Records artists left anymore.
No.
There's a handful of them. But, like, the more obscure ones still play around there because there's a musician named Deke Dickerson who plays now and sort of, like, revives that old kind of music. But he digs up, I don't know who's still alive. I don't think Charlie Feathers or Johnny Carroll or any of the, like, lesser-known artists are still alive. But the ones that are... I mean, did you get to see anybody else that was associated with Sun Records?
I didn't, unfortunately. I did go to Lafayette's, and there's a lot of great local bands that play there, but I didn't get to see any of the...
Yeah, it's hard now.
Yeah.
They're few and far between.
I know.
Yeah.
I mean, Jerry Lee is, what is he, like
81, which is younger than I thought. I thought he was older than that, actually.
Yeah, but still, I mean, 81, and he's still... Like, when he can still play.
Yeah.
You know?
Well, Christian was saying his fingers, he was, like, kind of, like doing this, I guess, when they were, like, with him.
Yeah, he's, like always doing stuff with his fingers.
He's probably, like, running through, like, music.
Keep them limber, you know?
That's so crazy.
Yeah.
Well, just kind of, like, the cast as a whole, how has this been different, filming this, in regards to anything else you've ever done on set? Like, I've heard that the morale of this cast is just, like, so close-knit.
Yeah, we are. We all lived... in the same building, and we were all
for how
like,
long? How long was production?
We got there at the very, very end of March, and I left July 11th.
Oh,
so
that's a fun camp.
Almost 4 months.
Wow. Man, that's
awesome. Great.
Yeah, and it was just a lot of fun, and we were all in it together. You know? Like, we were all in this new city, in this experience together, and there weren't any. on set. I don't know. Everyone was super, okay, yeah, there weren't any assholes on set. Everyone was super nice and accepting, and just along for the ride. And, yeah. And I've never been, this is my first series regular. I've worked on other shows, but mm-hmm. this is my first series regular. And it's totally different because I've also, not often do you see a show with so many series regulars. It was such a large ensemble. I mean, Glee, I guess, right?
Yeah.
But like
this Game of Thrones.
Yeah. That's one that you just forget.
Yeah.
You're like, who is that person? Oh, that's right. The Targaryens, they're coming back. So for me, it was something different because I've never worked on a set with so many cast members and.
Game of microphones, we'll call this.
Yeah, yeah, exactly. I love it. And so it was just a lot of fun getting to know everyone and experience it together and just. You know, grow together.
Yeah, I mean, that's a great point that you bring up, that it is such a large cast, because mm-hmm. each episode, I feel like we see so many different storylines mm-hmm. and so many different characters, so you're constantly trying to be like, okay, so this, like, you're keeping it track and keeping them all aligned, because there's so much more information you get. So that's, I mean, it's, for as an audience member, it's cool to watch that and, like, kind of get introduced to all these different people.
And it all tracks really well, too,
yeah. You know? And, like, you kind of start to see it all sifting through and crossing mm-hmm. lines, so, I mean, it's so intricately, like, and endearing to watch. It's just, it's phenomenal. Yes, of course. But just kind of like talking about you, like, what kind of music do you listen to? Do you listen to like Johnny Cash all the time?
I listen to him a good deal now.
Yeah.
I mean, I didn't listen to him all that much when I was growing up because, mm-hmm. you know, I didn't get it.
Because you didn't grow up in the 50s and 60s.
Yeah, and I just didn't get it, you know. And my mom was more into like the Bee Gees and stuff when I was younger. So,
yeah.
Now I listen to a whole different array of things. I listen to a lot of blues, like the Black Keys or Nathaniel Rateliff. I love mm-hmm. Jack White, The White Stripes, Eminem. I love Eminem. So I'm all across the board.
Yeah.
If it's good, I'll dig it.
Yeah. I mean, fair enough,
you
right?
know? I honestly kind of didn't like country growing up.
That's fair.
Yeah, but it's really grown on me.
Yeah.
You know, like Brad Paisley is awesome
I know, I get it. I hated country growing up, but then once I got away from, because I grew up in Missouri even though my family was in Boston, but once I got out of the sticks, that's when I found like a love for country.
Yeah,
I think most people who like it as an adult, you, if you're into the older, like if you're into Johnny Cash and you're into, you know, Hank Williams and, you know, old country, I think you might have discovered it later a lot of times.
Yeah.
Yeah. Yeah, I think country definitely is like a certain niche of people, because even I'm realizing I'm from the East Coast, and when I came out here, like, not a lot of people listen to country music. It's like not a big popular thing, except for some reason they do have Stagecoach, which is like fun and amazing, but here that you don't find it too common that people are listening to it. I said hey, and Siri's picking up.
Don't say Siri again, because she'll trigger.
I know. No, but I have a large question to ask you.
Okay.
Are you prepared for this?
Okay.
Yes.
Let's hold on to our seats.
Yes.
What is this thing that happens when you guys get number one on Twitter?
Yeah.
What is this thing?
This thing.
Yeah, this thing.
This shedding of clothes.
Like, how did it come about? Who has to do it?
That's me.
So just you. You're the only one in the cast that has to do
so
it.
Yeah, so it's funny because, like, I would always post on my Instagram story or Snapchat story or anything like that. Like, mm-hmm. you know, just me listening to music, like, walking around my apartment with my shirt off, whatever. And so Chad always, like, made fun of me. He'd be like, oh, dude, nice sexy video you posted earlier. And so then during the first episode, he was on Instagram Live, and he said, if we get the hashtag number one, Kevin's going to take his shirt off. And I was like, okay, sure, whatever. And we got it to number one. So they were like, you got to do it now. And I did it. And then we got to number one last week. I think we got to like number six or something tonight.
I think the stakes should get higher.
Yeah.
Just a shirt? Come on.
Yeah.
Everybody's saying shirts off.
I don't know. I might have to get my attorney involved in this one now.
No. I just was really curious because I saw that. And I was like, how does something like that come about?
Yeah. You know, you gotta sell the show.
I don't think you're
working hard for his art.
I think the show sells itself, honestly.
Great.
Yes. We don't need any.
Just a little cherry on top, you know?
I think all the people watching it, for them, it was just such a great thing to experience for mm-hmm. them. Yeah, after watching the show or before watching it, I'm sure they were super excited for that.
Yeah.
But yeah, I mean, honestly, overall, like, is there any like large takeaways that you're taking away from this experience, and kind of something that has you felt like has changed you after working on this show and continuing, hopefully, to work on this show?
Well, I got better at guitar, which was okay. Great. Thanks, Chuck. Thanks, Chuck Mead. You're the best. And my appreciation for the amount of work that goes into what happened there, and for the music. I mean, my musical spectrum, listening spectrum, grew quite a bit after working on this show something I love.
Yeah. You know,
good.
Yeah.
Yeah. Just meeting I think that's what's friends. Important is to introduce this music to a new generation that wouldn't have been familiar with it otherwise.
Exactly. But I mean, Elvis is still, isn't he like the number one selling artist of all time still?
Is he the number one of all time? I don't know.
I don't know. But I know he's up. He's the king. He's the king.
Can comment below. Check?
Drake. Where is he at? Because Drake knows everything, Elvis. Promise you.
Oh, look, I think if this is the real Jake Milligan, he's in the chat. Does he know? It says, maybe it's not the real Jake. Is that his name, right? Jake Milligan?
Drake Milligan is his name.
Yeah, if that's him, he's in the chat, but I guess we'll have to... He didn't answer. It just says, Christian, I see a future for you in comedy, except it says Connedy with no
M. Oh, Drake.
And I don't know if it's a poser or not. I can't tell. With that being said, thank you so much for being on the show. We're going to have so many other great special guests. Next week, we're going to have the Margaret Ann Florence, who plays Marion next week. So thank you guys so much for tuning in. Make sure that you subscribe to YouTube. Follow us on Snapchat, Facebook, Instagram, Twitter, all of the social medias. You can find me on Twitter at Ali Nasta and on Instagram at Ali Girl. And Kevin Fonteyne, where can they find you on social media?
Twitter is Kevin Fonteyne, spelled Fonteyne. And Instagram, same thing, Kevin Fonteyne.
Awesome. And Tamra, where can
I'm
they find
Tamra Brown. You can just Google me.
I love it.
Sounds good. All right, guys. We'll see you next week.
Bye.
From executive producers Maria Menounos, Kevin Undergaro, Phil Svitek, and the entire AfterBuzz TV staff, we would like to thank you for listening to the AfterBuzz TV network. To watch or listen to other after shows and post comments or questions, be sure to visit AfterBuzzTV.com. I'm Sir Richard Wentworth, and this has been a presentation of AfterBuzz TV.
See you later.
See you later.
And that's it.
The views expressed herein are those of the hosts only. Do not necessarily reflect the views of AfterBuzz TV or its owners or principals.